So welcome back to Room 1-on-1, and the Celtic are heading back to the City Discovery as a face-off against Dundee United for the first time this season at Tannadice Park on Sunday afternoon. I'm absolutely delighted to welcome back to the show Paul McNicholl from the fantastic Dode Fox Dundee United podcast. Well, Paul, how are you, bro?
I've been better. I've been better sporting-wise, but personally, I'm doing all right, Scott. Yourself?
Good. I'm good, thanks. I'm good. Usually on a Monday, I'm totally delicate, but I'm okay today.
Right, it's a bonus then.
Exactly, mate. Oh, Paul, you were on the show early January this year, in fact. And we had an excellent chat, as I remember that. And we'll go on to United in a second. But let's talk about your podcast, mate. I saw that you guys have done a good few pods, but you've done a few good live ones. Tell us about them. How did they go? How was that about?
We had a live show scheduled for a while, and then COVID hit, so we had to postpone it, and then we eventually managed to do a live show. I think it was around about February time. I think, if memory serves me, we'd done one in February, and we brought back an ex-United player, a guest that we'd already had on our podcast, Sean Dillon, because the standing joke is, like, when we get guests on the podcast, like, if you get any time from ex-players or fans, fellow fans, it's so much appreciated. But when we had Sean Dillon on, his episode lasted 4.5 hours. And we still had to cut through loads of our questions. So the standing joke for months was, we'll get him back. We'll definitely get him back. And then we did. We managed to get him back to finish that conversation off on the live show. So that was the first one. The second live show, we put it out. It was the same night as the Champions League. It was in the Gardine Theatre in Dundee, which holds about 400. It wasn't quite a sellout, but it wasn't far off it. And we had a Celtic employee there, Peter Houston.
Right,
and
right,
Craig Conway. So right. Houston, obviously, the manager of the Dundee United team when we won the Scottish Cup in 2010, and Craig Conway, scorer of 2 goals that day. So that was a great
tremendous
night.
Houston,
if he gets punted for Celtic, for what he's doing. I think he's like opposition analyst.
That's right.
If he gets punted for that anytime soon, he could be a stand-up comedian, because he was really, really funny.
Is that right? Aye.
He was brilliant. He was absolutely brilliant, telling some great stories. And, like, it's obviously, it's new to myself and Ronnie when you're having these live shows, because we're just a couple of fannies that are just speaking at a microphone once a week about our team. Like, we just give your opinion. So to take that step to have a live show, it's all new. It's all new to us. So the thinking was, I don't know if you'll get like 3 hours of content with one guy. You might. It just depends who that one guy is. But we thought, if we get two people at least. And we aimed for three guests at first. But then we thought, right, there's no point in getting three guests, because we've got two. They were both from the same team. They'll have stories. They'll probably be able to play off each other as well, which is exactly what happened. And I think everybody that was there enjoyed it. It was myself and Ronnie, my podcast buddy. We thought it was absolutely fantastic, and Houston and Craig Conway themselves loved it. So it was a roaring success.
Well done, mate. Well done. Absolutely brilliant. I mean, like, because I follow you now. By the way, my timeline is full of Dundee United because of you.
I apologise.
No. It's absolutely interesting. I was saying this to Nicky, the Hearts fan, last week, so obviously everybody in Scotland hates us and Rangers, right? We get that, kind of, I put up with that a long time ago, but you kind of think there's a camaraderie in that hatred, and I suppose there is, but see, like, you guys will come to your European result, but I couldn't believe the joy that was coming for Aberdeen fans and stuff like that. I was like, oh, what's good? Because I take no joy in it. I was like, oh, that's a bit of shame, you know what I mean? Wild.
Is that not because, like, we are of a similar level, like United, Aberdeen,
so.
Motherwell? Plus, let's be honest, like, when Motherwell got horsed out for the Irish team, United fans were taking a wee bit of pleasure in that as well. You know, it's changed days, because, like, when I was younger, and possibly you remember as well, Scott, I'm not trying to age you here, I think I'm a wee bit older than you, but it's when Scottish teams were in Europe, like, you kind of wanted them to do well.
100%.
I can remember the days when I was, like, in my teens, you did look for them to do well, but these days, that doesn't seem to be a thing.
That seems to be
well, you take more joy in them getting pumped out.
It's, I mean, like, I want everybody in Scotland to do well in Europe, bar the obvious. I mean, I made the fucking bones about that, I don't want anybody to but like, I was cheering you boys on. I mean, like we'll come to that anyway, right? But with regards to podcast, as I say, very well run podcast. You boys are excellent. I had Ronnie on last season as well. Mm-hmm. He done the first one for me. And you guys, I mean, these are excellent. And I'm not blowing smoke up your ass. These are excellent. And I was really, really happy that it went well, because mm-hmm. as you say, we're just punters, aren't we? We are no fucking professionals.
100%. 100%. I mean, I don't know how long you've been doing yours mm-hmm. for, Scott, but we're now into our fourth season, and you'll get, like, there have been journalists that call you or mm-hmm. News stations, and they're saying, look, can we grab a word, because you're kind of the voice of the fans. And we're always quick to say, we're not the voice of the fans, like, we're the voice of me and Ronnie.
Exactly.
Like, we don't speak for anybody else. We just give our opinion, rightly or wrongly. Sometimes people agree, sometimes people say, oh, you were talking shite there, and that's fine. That's fine, because when you listen back, there's a few times when I've like, nah, I was talking shite there. What was I on about? I didn't even agree with myself. But it's just, you just get an opinion. And usually the opinions, the ones where when you listen back and you think, oh, no, I've got that wrong. Because you get, well, you'll get a lot more Sunday games than United do. But when you've got a game on a Sunday, we record on a Sunday. Uh-huh. So it's almost like you're at the game and then you come home and then you record it. So you didn't actually get time to think about it. You didn't see any highlights. You didn't see any replays. So you're getting an opinion on something you've seen once, for an angle of, I sit behind the goal, so I'm behind the goal, something might have happened up the other end of the park. It's 50-50 whether I'm talking shite or no, you know, but it's honest. It's an honest opinion.
You're basically living the football player's life, isn't it? I mean, they get a fucking microphone straight into the
air. But mine's just self-inflicted. Mine's just self-inflicted.
Aye. No, it's funny, obviously. So you're asking about, I mean, I was doing podcasting fucking over 10 years ago with Celtic. We done a thing called the Tempest Stand, and mm-hmm. there was only like four or five of us out of there. Do you know what I mean? And we were all doing the same thing. But as you can imagine, in the Celtic world, everything's covered now. There's so many. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
The BBC wouldn't be fucking phoning us up for an opinion, I'll tell you that. we'd be the sweary beast of the Celtic podcast world, do you know what I mean?
We've got to reel it in now and again. There's no doubt about that. But, in general, you say what you want. How many Celtic podcasts are out there then? Because I would imagine there's probably quite a few.
There's plenty, right? So you kind of had your old school one. Like, so I'm on the Homebhoys. And the Homebhoys have been gone for 12 years as well. And I kind of jumped onto them late in the day. So they've been gone for years. And they started off as a phone-in. And you can imagine that fucking madness.
I can't imagine that.
You've got the Celtic Underground, who's the longest. And then you've got Axom, who have turned into this massive fucking channel. I mean, I think they've got like a Hibscott podcast, and then they don't fit with their music podcast and stuff. They would very much be getting calls after the BBC, your fancy coming on, or Sky. And they're very good at giving ins to young people looking to get into media as well, which is brilliant. And then you've got a whole collection of different ones. And you've now kind of got to the point where people are doing it as a job. Do you know what I mean? Like 67 Hail Hail, I don't know if you ever came across you guys. They boys are excellent. They're absolutely excellent. That's their job, and they're constantly looking for content. Do you know what I mean? Whereas we get invited into fucking press conferences and we ask people what their favourite colour is. Not that, you know
what I mean? that's an important question. Do you hate onions with your mints?
Exactly. Stuff like that. Exactly,
people need a can.
So and it's all different now. See, see what I do with you. I think 67 Hail Hail do it a wee bit, but nobody really else in the Celtic does this. I've kind of seemed to be the only person that kind of talks. Yeah. And then now I'm kind of putting them onto YouTube, so that seems to be working. I get a good bit of feedback with that as well. It's interesting you're talking about the guys bouncing off each other. We just done a Lisbon podcast. Mm-hmm. Celtic fans talk about Lisbon again. Wow. But it was more about, there was a couple of old fellas and they wanted to tell their story. And so that was like, we sat them down, and the hope was they were going to bounce off. Brilliant. You know, as a podcast guy, if you've got a guest on, the less you speak, the better.
It's their show. It's their show when they're on it, essentially. Yeah. And I also think there's a lot to be said for bringing two guests on at the same time, just for experience of doing this, because as you say, they've probably got to be for the same team, the same era at least.
Same era.
Yeah, and then they play off each other, and you might hear a list of questions in front of you, but you might know who to ask them because they're covering all the bases, and it's fantastic.
Perfect. Yeah, totally agree with you. Right. So let's go in here. So we're early in the season, so it allows us to have a wee brief look at last season. Now, I spoke to both you and Ronnie, as I said, from the pod last season, so we can rattle pretty much through this because we spoke about it then. So United kicked off the season with Tam Courts in position as full-time manager after Mickey Mellon had decided to leave the club. Courts, a former Celtic Hearts manager, had been head of tactical performance in the club's youth academy. Now, for him to get promoted was quite a thing at that point. In the League Cup, he came romping through the groups, wins over Celtic, Elgin, Arbroath, East Fife, set up a wee tie with Ayr United in the middle of August. 1-1 draw saw United edge out their championship opponents 4-3 on pens. Before a home tie with Hibs, disappointing 3-1 defeat saw his exit the cup. He's worth 3-0 down at half-time in that game. The league was up and down most of the season, apart from a period of seven games right in the middle of the season where United couldn't buy a win. I hope I don't offend you when I say this, but I think a weak enough league allowed United to rally enough points in the second half of the season to get themselves that fourth place finish. So for the 38 matches, 12 wins, 12 draws, 14 defeats, secured the fourth place. 2 points better than Motherwell in fifth, 13 points off your Hearts in third. 37 goals scored, 44 conceded, goal difference -7, 48 points on the board, and qualification for the Europa Conference League qualifiers. In the Scottish Cup, fourth round win over Championship elect Kilmarnock, 2-1 after extra time. A 1-0 win over Partick Thistle in the fifth round before a home draw with Celtic and a comfortable win on the day for Celtic. And the games between us last season, we had the 1-1 at Celtic Park early in the season, where I think Tam Courts came away with a lot of credit that day. We gave you a 3-0 doing at Tannadice.
Mm-hmm.
And then we had a 1-0 last kick of the ball win in January. And then we had the 1-1 draw after the season done for Celtic clinch the league. Well, Dylan Levitt scored that absolute fucking worldie. So, all that in mind, I know it's last season, it's a bit old and that. What was your overall thoughts of the season all in? I mean, we'll come to Tam Courts leaving in a second and I'd like to get your opinion on that. But just in general, because Tam Courts came out of the season with a lot of credit, but see when I'm looking at the results, I don't know, I'd like to hear your opinion.
Yeah, well, just what you said there, Scott, like you said, I hope you didn't take offence, and absolutely I didn't take offence. I think in any other season, if you finish the league campaign with 48 points, you're probably not going to be anywhere near fourth place.
Mm-hmm.
But it was, I mean, Motherwell as well, they went on a run after New Year where, what did they win? One game?
One game,
and they got into Europe.
No.
It was just, obviously it was yourselves and that horrible mob on the other side of Glasgow that were vying for the title. That's a given. Before the Abaz kicked, Hearts were good enough to put themselves in a position where they were never going to catch the top two, and they were never going to be caught by anybody else. So there's, like, myself and Ronnie spoke about it on our podcast when we were coming up to play Hearts in games near the end of the season. We were thinking, they've got literally nothing to play for here. They can't be caught, and they can't catch anybody. They're just trying to no get injured for the cup final, essentially.
As you rightly say, and I said this to Nicola last week, because they were so comfortable in that third position, it almost allowed them to play for the cup, didn't it?
Yes, for weeks and weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think from United down, there really wasn't much. Like Dundee were poor, but in the games where we played Dundee, there wasn't much in it. You know, on the day, there wasn't much in it. When you look at the league, you're thinking, right, well, one team finished fourth and one team finished bottom. There must have been quite a gap. But for fourth down, there wasn't really that much in any of the games. Aberdeen were piss poor last season. Hibs were poor. And, I mean, overall, United fans were absolutely delighted to finish fourth. But at the same time, you were thinking, we are only finishing fourth because we've been slightly less shite than everybody else. That is, like, that was kind of what it felt like. But obviously, we were grateful to finish fourth because, like, being a United fan the last umpteen years, it was once again another progression because we were in the Championship for what seemed like forever. It was 4 years. You get out there, you get into the top league, you consolidate, and then you kind of better it again. We finish in fourth, and now here we are. I kind of see we're finishing fourth this year, the way it's going. But again, it's early doors. You never know. So definitely last season, it was definitely deemed a success because after the first game of the season, when we were just absolutely garbage, we got hosed 2-0.
Aberdeen.
2-0 for Aberdeen, yeah. The manager came out after the game and said that we were unlucky, said that we had great spells. Boys were just shaking their head. They couldn't believe what they were hearing, never mind what they had just watched for 90 minutes previous. And then the next week they went and beat Rangers, like a team that hadn't been beat the whole previous season. Mm-hmm. So it was a right up and down season. Like you touched on as well, they went through six or seven game spell where I think there was one draw and six defeats or something like that. But somehow, some way, like the stars aligned for United to finish fourth place. Mm-hmm. I don't know how it happened, but it did.
I mean, last season was the epitome for me. I mean, people who listen to this podcast will hear me say this fucking constantly, but the split's a bag of shit, right? I think it's the stupidest thing on the planet. And the point to the matter is Ross County finished on 41 points with minus 14 goals, and Aberdeen finished on 41 with minus 5 goals. So Livingston, Hibs, St Mirren and Aberdeen would all have finished above Ross County. Do you know what I mean? And it's like a shambles. Shambles. But
yeah, it's bizarre at times. The way that the final league placings look, if you're not too au fait with football, you might be looking at that and thinking, how come that team in fifth's got less points than the team in eighth? It doesn't make any sense to them.
Exactly. So in summary, I mean, you must have been disappointed. When we beat you in the cup, I was a bit nervous going to that game. I was expecting, and I thought Celtic played well enough that day. Mm-hmm. And considering that game, the 1-1 game at Celtic Park, Dundee United came out with a lot of credit. I think Celtic were kind of unlucky on the day. I'm pretty sure we hit the bar a couple of times. But then you look at the 1-0 game, that was tight as you fucking get.
Yeah, United defence, in the first one, the 1-0 game, from a United point of view, it was a great performance from us because, of course, when you go to Celtic Park, you know you're going to hit a ride your luck. Like there's no team in this country that goes to Celtic Park and plays you boys off the pitch. Like if you're going to get anything for there, you've got to be at your absolute best. Hope that Celtic aren't at their absolute best and ride your luck a bit. So it felt like we did that in that game. It was
that's high.
Yeah. So he hung his bits up about 3 million years ago. So it's been a while. I think it was a dinosaur in the crowd that day. It was a long, long time ago.
No, I mean, it's also the same as the cup, right? It sounds patronizing as hell. And I know how it sounds, and I don't mean it this way, but see, I don't dislike Dundee United. I actually do. Like, I remember watching you in the cup final against Murrow, and my family's all Murrow, on one side's Murrow, or Celtic Murrow, and I remember cheering on Dundee United. I love Jim McLean and all that part. I mean, however, Dundee United in the cup is almost a bigger gimme as Celtic have ever got. I think it was 1982. Last time you guys beat us in the cup.
Yeah, like there's. I don't know. You could speak to every single United fan. Nineveh look forward to games against Celtic. Nineveh. Just because of the record, it's unbelievable how one team can have such a holdover. Like we have beat you a couple of times at Tannadice, like for sure. But I don't know, Ken. Like if you go back to the last even 100 games that we've played, we must have only won about four or five. It's absolutely ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous. And we've had good teams. We've had shite teams. You guys have had very good teams. You've had very average teams during that spell. And it doesn't seem a matter of toss. It just doesn't seem a matter of toss. So last season, the first 1-0 game, and even though The 3-0 game at home in the league, that was as poor as we had played.
Yes.
At that point of the season.
That was arguably our best performance of the season.
Yeah. So that was the complete opposite of what we need to have. We need to be at our best and you guys need to be off it. Yeah. And that day, we were off it and you boys absolutely strolled it. Mm-hmm. And then the 1-0 game at Celtic Park, that was an absolute sickener because, like, you boys are... On the balance of possession and all that, you probably deserved it because, you did deserve it because you scored, we didn't. That's how football works. But being a United fan and Ken and that we were up against it, there was a few injuries that day as well. We had young Lewis Nielsen at the back, we had Callum Butcher in at the back, and we held on and stood
for
him.
And set the man sent half, right?
Yes, yeah. And it made no difference. You still somehow, some way got the job done. And it was like the biggest kick in the buzz that I've had today, the last time you've done that to us. So it was a saying. The Scottish Cup, that was no surprise to lose 3-0. I mean, it was tight until you scored.
That's right.
And then we'll get to him, but your new subby keeper, he threw in that night as well at the near post. And I think it was the second half he done that. And then... I think that the last time that we met each other last year, May the 11th, you guys took the lead, didn't you? You guys took the lead and then Levitt equalised.
Yeah.
And that was a night where, like, a draw was all you needed and a draw was all we needed to qualify for Europe. So once the game got to a certain stage, and it was 1-1 late into the second half, and I'm sure Jota done a wee bit of wizardry on the wing, cut inside, had a great shot, and Sigrist had an absolutely brilliant save. Yeah. He had a really strong wrist. But apart from that, it just seemed like both teams were content because it done the job for both of us.
Austria, West Germany, is that what you're saying here?
Yes. No, quite as blatant as that, but something similar, yes.
Right, let's go into this season then, right? So, another season of upheaval. Third summer on the bounce, United need to locate a new manager. As Tam Courts decided to leave the club on the 14th of June, subsequently joining Hungarian side Honved of Budapest, got his first win last night, I was led to believe. So that meant on the 20th of June, Jack Ross was appointed the Arabs' new manager. How did you feel on both hands? I mean, Tam Courts is leaving. You're kind of like that, but are you gutted about it?
I wasn't gutted about it. No, I certainly wasn't gutted about it, but it came out of nowhere. Like, I'm not sure how the rest of Scottish football felt, but as a United fan, we were thinking, Christ almighty, like he's just in the door he's been interviewed on Club TV. He's talking about his kind that they've prioritised certain areas for signings that they're going to make for next year to strengthen the team and whatever. And then he was initially linked to be a team in Croatia, I think it was.
That's Rijeka. Right. Yeah, Rijeka.
And then the rumour came out, and again, I say rumour, to this day, I don't know if it was true or no, but it was like he'd been stitched up. So there was that floating about, and then lo and behold, he was away. He was away to this Hungarian team, Honved. And it was just so sudden. But now, a few weeks on, I can now sit and think, right, okay, he's obviously been given this opportunity. I think United these days are probably a bigger team than that Honved. I think back in the day, they were quite a big team
over
there.
They were one of the bigger teams,
100%. So wages-wise, I don't know if it's a life-changing deal for him or not, or if he's just ambitious. He just fancies trying something different. He's 5'5". He probably fancies getting a year of stun on him. And he's stock as well, because he's maybe smart enough to realise, look, I got 48 points this season, last season. If I get that again, that's probably not going to be a success because it's not going to be fourth place in the league. So he maybe left when his stock was at the highest it can ever be. And again, like that, I'm speculating. I'm just assuming that's one of the reasons that he may have decided to go. So it kind of makes sense now, but at the time, it come out of nowhere. I thought it was a joke. I couldn't believe it. I thought he's got a great agent. And he left. And then, a couple of weeks later, Jack Ross rolled in. And it was probably quite a well-received appointment. Me personally, and we joked about it on the Dode Fox podcast, we Ronnie, like, I was never sold. I used to go on about Jack Ross every other week. when he wasn't a United manager. I just did not. I wasn't a big fan of him.
One of them, aye.
I wasn't a big fan of him, and it's nothing to do with just because he wears a cardi all the time, or he kind of win at Hampden in big matches. But I like, if you go back over his time as a manager, he must have done well at Alloa. But I'll openly admit, I'm not really sure what his record was at Alloa. But I'm assuming he's done well to get the St Mirren gig. And then when he got the St Mirren gig, I felt like he was very reliant upon the boy Lewis Morgan that was there. He was the superstar in the league. And when I say the league, remember it was the championship. And I should can because United were in it at that time. And he pipped United to the title. And then on the back of that, he got the Sunderland job. And I would never have that against anybody because Sunderland have been a bit of a basket case for a number of years. No overly certain how that went, but obviously he got emptied at some point. And then he came up to Hibs. And like, I think he was doing all right. In my opinion, he probably should have done better. But again, I felt like similar to his time at St Mirren, I thought he was very reliant on Martin Boyle.
Mm-hmm.
So in my mind, I'm thinking, right, okay, so he goes to teams and he's relying on like one star player. And I couldn't see, like, I would probably say United's star player these days is probably Dylan Levitt, but he's no the same as like a Lewis Morgan or a Martin Boyle, like just different dynamic altogether. And I'm not saying that he's any worse, I'm not saying he's any better, but it's a different sort of player. So I wasn't overly sold on Jack Ross coming in, but listening to fellow Arabs, listening to Ronnie on a weekly basis, they had us convinced, like, no, he's obviously the best man out there. So I've ended up getting on board with it.
You've got no other option, really, have you? You know what I mean? That's your fucking team. You've got to give these guys...
Of course, yeah. I don't want to be the guy that in 4 months is like, you. See, I tell you he was shite.
Nobody wants to be that guy.
I want to be the boy that people point at and say, that boy was completely wrong. Nay hassle in any way, shape or form getting dealt that. I really hope I am wildly wrong on this.
The Jack Ross thing, I don't know, because there's guys on our pod who were advocating when Neil Lennon was going through his hardships, let's get Jack Ross. Yeah. And like you, right, I remember Celtic signing guys from the Championship with big potential. I don't think Lewis Morgan was ever used right at Celtic, right? Because there's no doubt he's a talent. I've seen what he's doing in the MLS. He's definitely a talent. We were playing him up front and stuff like that. And I mean, it was just a bad thing. But I remember signing Scott Allen. I just wasn't sold on him. I was like, because these guys... And Dylan McGee was an R guy who succeeded at Hibs doing in the first division. So Jack Ross at St Mirren passed me by. He got the Sunderland gig and... do you know what went for him? That documentary. Because like you said, it basically showed Sunderland as this maniac club ran by two guys who didn't have a Scooby-Doo, and then they shot him when he probably shouldn't have shot him. And Hibs, and the fact that Hibs kind of fell off a cliff has made people...
After he left.
People are kind of going, maybe it wasn't that bad. Even though the Hibs boys I spoke to were all going, oh, his time's done. So I think what happens after him has allowed him to kind of stay that level.
Mm-hmm.
Because I was surprised, because his stock is pretty damn high. I mean, when you got him, there was kind of big talk, he'd knock back St Mirren and stuff like that. Do you know what I mean? He had his heights a lot higher. But
he's a media darling as well, which I don't think harms him. Like when he was out of work there, he was on BBC quite a lot, and he speaks very well. He's very intelligent. He kens what he's on about. So that definitely goes for him in the eyes of the media. But it's a strange one, as you say, because it's not quite 50-50. But there's a lot of punters that can they I doubt about it somehow, some way, and they maybe kind of put their finger on quite why. They didn't believe that he's a top coach, but there is something in the back of people's minds that, and there's a few doubts about him.
Yeah. And it's interesting you talk about the media darling thing. That counts a lot in this country, doesn't it? That really does.
Yes.
I mean, guys like John Hughes and stuff like that never ever get the same criticisms as even guys like Ronnie Dyer at Celtic. I mean, it was a case of we hate you, we're going to attack you at every opportunity. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Right. So, as with all new managers, Ross is looking to implement himself on the squad and on the team. And sure enough, we'll start with the outgoing first. Right. So, Maxim Biamo, a French striker, left after one season and three appearances. 21-year-old Kosovo under 21 cap Florian Holti left. Former Scotland international Kevin McDonald departed as well. And left-sided Argentine player Adrian Sporl left also. All three of them at the end of their contracts and have since failed to find a club. Former Motherwell keeper Trevor Carson left the club again, signing for St Mirren for an undisclosed fee after spending much of last season on loan at Morecambe. Young players Rhys Caves and Lennon Walker, midfielders, left on frees to Gretna and Bowness, whilst Nathan Cooney joined Brechin. Fullback Lewis Nelson departed the club for Hearts after rejecting a contract extension. Benjamin Segrist, who we spoke about, his contract also finished and joined Celtic. Callum Butcher left for Burnley Albion again, and Mark Connolly departed the team for an undisclosed fee, moving to Derry City after being out on loan for the past two seasons. Finn Robson, Adam Hutchison, Jack Newman, Declan Glass and Chris Mockery all left in the clubs and loans to Kelty, Montrose, Peterhead, Derry City and Dunfermline respectively. Incomings. Stephen Fletcher was picked up on a freebie after Stoke. Dylan Levitt was picked up for an undisclosed fee from Manchester United after an outstanding season last season. Craig Sibbald, the 27-year-old winger, was picked up on a free from Livingston. 31-year-old Australian goalkeeper was signed. I've not even put his name down. Right, Australian.
Mark Brigitte.
Mark Brigitte. We'll come to him. He was signed for an undisclosed fee from Central Coast Mariners. Azel Behic, another Aussie, a left back this time, was picked up on a free from Grinspoor. The 31-year-old has represented Australia 52 times and spent over the last 10 years in Turkish football and also had a short spell with PSV. Glenn Middleton, the Rangers winger midfielder, was picked up again for an undisclosed fee after four loan spells over the last three seasons. And finally, Jamie McGrath was picked up for Wigan on a season loan. Formerly of St Mirren, McGrath only moved to Wigan earlier this year and has represented Ireland on six occasions. So, you've practically seen all of them now, right? So I'm going to fling the two of them. What was your thoughts when you were getting these guys? What was your thoughts on the guys going out? And now you've seen them. What's the thoughts? What is your thoughts?
the guys that went out, it wasn't really a surprise, other than Lewis Nielsen. It seems like something somewhere, through the outside looking at it, looks like somebody's made an arse of something. Because right. I think he was wanting to stay, so I've heard anyway. But he was asking for something in his contract that was stating he'll get X amount of games. Now I don't know if that was 10, 20, 30 games. I'm not sure what it was, and I'm not sure if that's commonplace in contracts. But that's what I heard. And United must have went to him and said, "Look, we can't guarantee that," and he's went to Hearts. So right now, I would say that's quite a loss for us because he. Mm. He's just a young lad. I think he's maybe 19. He is built like a future heavyweight champion of the world. he's a great athlete. There's loads of potential with him. Loads of potential. So that one, to me personally, I would say that was quite a loss that we've let him out the building. The other ones, I suppose losing Segrist was a blow. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't a shock. It wasn't a shock because he was... I think he thought he was going to leave. And I think the club thought he was going to leave at the start of last season. And that's right. Why we brought Trevor Carson in. Mm-hmm. And I think Trevor Carson was signed probably under the pretense that, look, you're going to be our number one.
Yeah.
Which would have been fine. You know, I would take him as our number one right now.
As I remember last season, you kind of floated him in for some games, didn't you? You kind of
yes. Yeah, he played at Ibrox. It was we call it the COVID game because we had a couple of 16-year-olds in that day.
I remember that.
And behold, Rangers, they beat away a penalty, if you can believe that. but and it's not often I'm fair to them, but in fairness, it was a penalty. But they beat us 1-0 that day.
So
Carson played a few games for us. He never really let me down. And then for whatever reason, I'm not sure if it was family reasons or what. You I mean, obviously, when you're a, when you're a punter, you're no a party to exactly what's going on. It's just hearsay, a lot of the stuff that you get told. But he ended up on loan down at Morecambe. Whether or not that was to be closer to his family, I have no idea. But then at the end of the season, we knew that Sigrist was leaving. And for whatever reason, Carson was then sold for a nominal fee. Christ knows how much it was. Probably about 10 grand or something to St Mirren. And it's sitting here today, I could say it's a bit of a head scratcher because we could deal with him. Because the goalkeeping situation at Tannadice just now is a bit up in the air. Nobody's really sold on either keeper that we've got. But the players going out, and even the players on loan, it's not really... It wasn't really a surprise to many people.
Mm-hmm. So what about the incomings? I mean, Dylan Levitt pretty much was a talker. Fucking outside us two, it was pretty much a talker Scottish football. I mean, he was impressive in most games I've seen him. You'd tell me better, but obviously when you went through that wee spell, but he looked like a 6-7 player every week, sometimes pushing an 8. And to the point that Celtic fans were saying, there's a guy that we should be looking for. I mean, I am of the opinion that signing for Dundee United and being in this league is a good thing for us. Say it blows away the league, it's somebody Celtic and Rangers will be looking at. You know what I mean? Because we've nowhere.
That's just the way it works. For United to be able to bring him in. For Man United, but we were kind of hoping against hope that we would get him back on loan because his contract situation down at Old Trafford was he was out of contract. However, Man United had a year option, and the talk that I never ever understood, to be honest with you, the talk was it would be better for United if they take out their year option so that we can get him back on loan. But I was thinking, why would they give him a year's contract just to stick him back out on loan at us? So that. People were hoping and kind of praying that he was going to come back because he was so good for us last season. So to sign him for, again, it's these undisclosed fees that we don't really care about. I would imagine...
You must have heard rumours.
Well, 300 grand was the reported fee in the press, but like you didn't care. you just didn't. And I don't know why these things are undisclosed, Scott, because...
Seems to be mail them, doesn't it?
For Tannadice, certainly, every time there's a fee, it's undisclosed. But then they come out in the accounts like a year later. It's only a secret for 12 months. It doesn't make any sense to me. But that's just me moaning again. So to get him in the door, that was a great signing for the club. Yeah. And when I look at all the signings that we've made, again, I'll touch on the keepers in a second, but I think it's been a good transfer window for United. Mm-hmm. I personally think, looking at the squad, that it's a better squad than it was last season. But for some reason, and I kind of put my finger on it, and then I get piped to, they're just not performing like they can what a football is. Mm-hmm. It's just been dire the last few weeks. But the goalkeeping situation, last season, halfway through, we brought in Carl Johan Eriksson. Right. And he's a Finnish international keeper, and he sat on the bench behind Benji, and rightly so, because Benji, he did go through a dodgy spell of 4 or 5 games. But to be honest, you probably get away with that at Dundee United. If Benji was to get a game for you guys and hear a dodgy spell of 4 or 5 games, he's probably either back on the bench or in the stand. You know, it hurts to say, I suppose, but there's just different standards. There's different standards at the two clubs. You didn't get away with it. So he sat on the bench, and then in the summer, obviously Benji's left, or Ben, now I think he's calling himself, now that he's moved to the West Coast. No Benji anymore, it's his Dundee name. And then we've brought in this guy for Australia that nobody had really heard of. I think he's played one time for the Australian national team. And on the face of it, he looked good. Like when you see him on the park, he's very comfortable with the bat, his feet, he moves the boot, he's very calm, he communicates via the defence. But he's in the few games that he's had, he's made a couple of errors. Like now, he's made a couple of good saves as well, but he's made a couple of errors. And we all know, anybody that watches football, like if anybody on the park, you didn't want him to be making an error, it's the keeper because it cost you a goal. So he got dropped at the weekend there, or rested, however you want to phrase it. To me, he got dropped. And so I'm assuming his confidence is fairly low. Mm-hmm. The boy, Carl Johan Eriksson, we didn't really care what to make of him, just because he's everything that Birragetti is now. Like, Birragetti looks dead comfortable with a bat at his feet. Eriksen looks like he doesn't want to bat anywhere near his feet. Birragetti is quite confident coming for crosses. I'm not saying he gets them, huh? Eriksen is, he's no great at coming for crosses, in my opinion. They both look like no bad shot stoppers, but then again, that's a goalkeeper's bread and butter. You should be a good shot stopper. That is the one thing you're getting paid for, is stop shots. So the goalkeeping situation is a slight concern at the minute. I don't know what they're going to do. There was talk in the summer of bringing in that big beardy galoot, Xander Clark, St Johnston. I still don't think he's got a team either. I think he's a free agent still, but I can't see United signing him, because it's all relative, but United must have paid out a fair bit of dosh this summer assembling this squad.
I was going to say, much to United, you paid for that Mark Birragetti, fairly.
Maybe 100 grand, I'm not sure. I'm totally guessing.
It's a strange one with Xander Clark, isn't it? Because you left early doors in June, so you're basically kicking about the house, don't you?
apparently United made a play for him. They did try to get him, and again, a deal in rumours in my Dundee bunker here. But apparently he was mucking about. He was wanting more time to think about it. He was apparently wanting more dosh. How much of that's true, I don't know, but at the end of the day, he's still without a team, so he's getting paid nothing, as far as I can see now. So it's but hey ho.
So about the Aussie fullback, how's he looking? That's quite a pedigree he's got.
Well, that was it. When you sign him, I got to be honest and say I'd never heard of him.
Never
heard of him at all. And then you see that he's played for his country 50-odd times. And it's Australia. It's no like in the Faroe Islands or something. And you think, well, Australia, there's no mean feat getting into that squad. But the couple of times that we've seen him so far, you think he's a wing back, and the emphasis should be more on wing than back, because he's no the best at defending, for what I've seen. But he is quite keen to get forward and maybe start attacks, be part of attacks. But when it comes to tracking back and actually being a defender, that doesn't appear to be his strength. So it's an issue. Like, we do have a left back. We've got another guy, Scott McMahon, that was signed for Hamilton a year or so back. So it wouldn't surprise me if Scott McMahon's on the left side of the defence on Sunday, purely because we're going ahead to defend more than we're going to be attacking, I'm assuming. Mm-hmm. Unless you get three players sent off in the tunnel.
So Glenn Middleton, he's another guy. I mean, my opinion is obviously tinted now by the fact that he scored that absolute stunning goal against AZ. But he was somebody who was tipped for greatness, and he kind of disappeared at St Johnstone for me. So they were talking him very well on the telly at that AZ game. It's about time he stood up. It's about time he showed everybody the quality he's got. I'm presuming from the league game so far, that's not really happening.
No, well, I mean, he's looked all right. Mm. He's looked all right. Like, against AZ, he scored that goal. It's a great goal. It was, to be fair to the team, it was a great performance on the night. That can't be denied. And the United fans' concern is everything that's come after that game, because the wheels have just fell off. Like, we got beat for Livingston at home. You should never be accepting a defeat for Livingston. But they are a stuffy team. They're hard to play against. United didn't have a particularly great record against them. We then go out of Holland and we get our arse felt every which way to Sunday, and we get 7 goals against us. And then we come back and we go to Tynecastle, which was never going to be easy. And we got pumped there as well. And then on Saturday
there were two stinking games to come straight after the back of even playing the first leg. There were stinking games, because you know yourself, playing Livingston at any point is tragic. I mean, they're hardly ever going to come up and play open attack and footballer, and it's going to be and then, as we say, Hearts, no matter what you think about Hearts, Hearts are a hard team, and at Tynecastle, it's a cunty game, no matter who it is.
100%. 100% for weeks prior to that, I said to Ronnie, I go to missed games. I didn't manage to make it over to Alkmaar. Ronnie did. But I go to miss games, and I said to Ronnie, I says, weeks before it, I says, I think I kind of will be going to Tynecastle, because after a European game, Tynecastle record there last season wasn't very good. I just kind of see we're getting anything. I ended up going. But like 42 seconds in, when you're 1-0 doing for your ex-striker, I thought, here we go. What did I bother for? What did I bother my arse coming through to the capital for? So, we're in a bad place at the moment for whatever reason. I don't know how. We're performing to less than the sum of our parts, in my opinion. Whereas you get a team like Livingston, you look at them and you think, they'll be mugs. Can you be able to walk over them? But they didn't. They managed to be average players that come together, and they actually play to more than the sum of their parts.
Martindale can be a bit of a tube, but by God, he's proven he's worth in this league, isn't he, man? He definitely is.
100%. He kens what he's doing. Like, no, he might hear that annoying, squeaky voice, but he kens what he's doing. Fair play to him.
Right. I'd like to kind of get into the games a wee bit harder, but we'll talk about the squad, because there's a couple of guys I just want to know about, right? So last season, I think when I spoke to Ronnie, at that point, Charlie McGrew and Ryan Edwards were making a good partnership. Charlie McGrew, I'm hearing, is coming in under a bit of criticism. Well, along with the whole team, to be honest. But the defence is obviously, and he's obviously the big Bohidia. So is it a case of Charlie McGrew, his days are by him? I wouldn't think so. Or is it just a case of the defence and the goalkeeper are going to get it stinking whilst the boys are tapped? Because the guys I've picked out, right? So Ryan Edwards, Charlie McGrew, because they were led to believe, I think it was Ronnie said to me, they looked like a really good partnership.
Yes, yeah.
Neskinen is a guy that I always think's a good player, right? He looks like hot and cold. I always liked him. I told Ronnie this. I went Ingolstad in the game, and I had them as a winger, and I loved them. You know what I mean? And when you signed them, I was like, fucking hell. And you signed them for like $300,000 or something, eh? And then comes the enigma of Tony Watt. And Tony Watt, you signed Tony Watt, and Motherwell just fell off a cliff, whilst you guys never... You really never really get the Tony Watt bounce I was expecting. Is all that fair?
Yeah, I think the Tony Watt bounce that we got was, or to our benefit, was Motherwell falling away. I think it done more damage to them, and it allowed us to finish above them in the league, which obviously is more prize money and whatever. So it was probably a gamble that paid off for that sense. But we signed him. He was top scorer in Scotland when we signed Tony Watt, and he scored one goal for us in, I don't know how many games he's played, 26, 27 games, something like that. Wow. And when we signed him, even though he wasn't scoring last season, at the tail end of last season, I felt he's contributing, you know, he's given the team something that it didn't have before he arrived. But this season, he's out of form, he's reverting to type. It's hard to say, but he's not really getting the team in, and he's still playing on this left wing. He's the furthest thing away from a left winger I've ever seen. I've no doubt he's got ability. He can contribute to a team. No doubt in that at all. But whether it's him or whether it's us not utilising him, I'm not sure. To touch on your point about Niskanen, hot and cold, that probably would be the best way to sum him up. I think a lot of fans think it's mainly cold, though there's no much hot. And he's kind of a subby most weeks. He gets on maybe 20 minutes at the end of the game. So still waiting to see him pull up a couple of trees and do something. And as for Ryan Edwards and Charlie McGrew, they went into their best form last season when big Ross Graham, the young lad at United, he spent the first half of last season out on loan at Dunfermline, and he started the season very well when they were playing their League Cup games. And then obviously the struggles through there, Peter Grant lost his job. Big Ross he wasn't even in the squad, missed weeks at Dunfermline, and then he came back to United in January, which wasn't a surprise. But the surprise was he then came on for us in the 1-0 game at Celtic Park, January 29th. Now, ultimately, we lost that game. But from that point on, he was almost an ever-present in the team. And that was reflected, and there was a change. Like, United went to the three at the... They said it was three at the back. Like, it depends if you if you're under the cosh, then it's Fev at the back, I suppose.
Aye, 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 aye.
But it was, there was three in the middle. It was Big Ross Graham, Edwards, and Mulgrew. And it just worked. It just worked. We also, we didn't defend in a particularly high line. Probably the reason for that is because Charlie Mulgrew, as good as he can be on his day, Edwards, he'll head a rahan, he'll throw his body in the way of everyone. Ross Graham, he was excellent. None of them have got any pace. Real pace. Mm-hmm. So this season, the struggles, and I'm not saying this is the hail cause of United's struggles, but this season, Jack Ross is playing a back four. So we've got a left back. And on the last couple of weeks, it's been the boy Beach for Australia.
Mm-hmm.
Well, to me, it doesn't look like he ever wants to defend. He just wants to get forward. We've got Liam Smith at right back, who again, to me, is out of form. And you've got Edwards and Mulgrew in the middle. And we're playing quite a high line. So when boys are running at them, the crowd are going mental at them because they're backing off and they're backing off. But my thoughts are they're backing off because they can. If the boy gets past them and it's a foot race, they're done. Like, they're cooked. They're no getting back. So United fans were kind of... The one main feature about us and our success last season was our defence. Like, we were able to sit back and defend, and it might not have been the greatest thing to watch, but you can yourself. The first thing that you want to do is be organised at the back. If you didn't concede, you're not going to lose. And then you build for there and build for there again. But we're just shipping goals anytime the opposition have got the badges now. So we're hoping that Jack Ross goes to like a five at the back or a three at the back on Sunday. Let's be honest, that'll be a five. I'd go flat back 10 myself. but unless he does that, then we're really struggling. And just in front of the defence as well, like, we've got Levitt, who I've already said I think is an absolutely great player. We've got Harks. We've got Jamie McGrath, who's came in, like, good player.
Mm-hmm.
But we didn't have somebody that sits. So the problem that we had on Saturday against St Mirren is we were losing the bar. Our midfield was losing the bar. And it could be just outside St Mirren's box. But St Mirren were then running through on our defence because our midfielders were in front of it. And we didn't have anybody just sitting in the hole, just in the shitey job in football, basically, just destroying things like Neil Lennon used to do for you guys. It was a very...
What was the name of the fella you had at the start of last?
John Fuchs.
Fuchs. I mean, that kind of destroyer. Even going back to guys like even Gomez done the job for a good while.
Excellent. Yep. We've got nobody like that. Nobody like that just now.
It was interesting. I was going to say to you that I like Jamie McGrath at Dundee United. I thought Jamie McGrath was a smashing player. It kind of sticks in my throat when guys, top players we hear, go down there and just get lost in the system. It kind of, I want people to leave this league and boom, so everybody kind of goes,
yeah,
they're no total daddies up there, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
And it kind of stuck my, because I look at it looked like it didn't get a chance. And then when you guys signed you, and you said this European game coming up, I was like, fuck me, that's a good signing. But like you say, if your defence isn't confident in itself, you need that cover in you, don't you? You definitely need, you can't have the guys up there trying things and losing the ball. But
100%. And again, to touch on the keeper issue, that probably doesn't help as well because the fans are a bit nervous when the ball's coming near the keeper. so you could only assume that the defenders in front of them are thinking, oh, God, what's he going to do? Is he going to parry this out? Is he going to drop it? Is he going to spill it? What's he going to do here? So it's United aren't in a great vein of form. Coming up against.
Right, we'll go to that, right? So, not a great start, right? We'll no labour on things here. So, you just had a couple of, you played only a couple of friendlies. Defeat by Sunderland, then Fleetwood Town. And that led right into the opening day of the season. 1-1 draw with Kilmarnock offered early hope. I watched the extended highlights of that one. It was an itchy peachy game. I think Harks has been totally stupid to get sent off. You've scored an absolute belter of a goal. I mean, first time you've seen Fletcher in Scotland for a long time, and he's fucking a wee back heel, and then a dinky a finish. And then he conceded the goal. I think Kilmarnock will do it, in fairness. I think the game is itchy peachy. However, you get to that point, you concede. It touches right back to what you just said a minute ago. Our strength was fucking defending. Wasn't nice, but we defended and we gave it. So you can see that goal was a body blow right for the off. Then you had the AZ game. Amazing, right? And let's be honest with it, how he's never actually finished the game 2, maybe 3 on that day. I was I was kind of gutted because I thought the fact that you never got a second one was going to hurt you.
Little did I know. Six in it, still wouldn't have been enough.
And then you went to that Livingston game. I didn't see the Livingston game, but I can just imagine it. I mean, I've looked at the stats about it, and what the stats fucking really tell you, but it's very much itchy peachy again.
There wasn't much in it. Let's be honest, there wasn't much in the game.
What I do notice is you've got all the possession. I mean,
we had all the possession. I heard all the possession on Saturday. Nothing.
Every game I'm looking at, I've got fucking either most or a good bit of the possession. So there is some failing, isn't there? I mean, it sounds to me, as somebody who played football at a very low level and a very bad level, I have to say for myself, I was a defender, and see if the knobs up front never scored, all the pressure was on fucking me, wasn't it? So it just looks like to me, you boys on the scoring. And as you say, all the deficiencies are just getting shown up because nobody's sure or nothing. Do you think it's just a case, it's just early doors and things haven't settled yet?
I hope so. I hope so. But again, I'll go back to it. I think that the players that we've brought in, certainly some of the players that were already there, I think they're good enough. I think we should be getting better at them. Now, I'm not saying United will ever challenge for the league.
No.
But we should be doing better. United may have had 70% possession of the ball on Saturday there against St Mirren, but they deserved to lose 3-0. They were lucky. It was only 3-0. And it's bizarre when you say that, because people these days in football, they're like, but if possession's king, you know, if you hit the bar the time the opposition can't score. Well, we had the bar the most of the time, and we never looked like scoring on Saturday. Never. St Mirren had the bar. St Mirren played to their strengths. They were organised. Mm-hmm. They sat in. They defended very comfortably, very easily against us. And when they broke with a purpose. And they just picked us off and they took their chances. And it was almost a perfect game plan against a team that's low in confidence, creating nothing, and couldn't keep kids out of sweet shop.
I felt that was the Hearts game as well. The Hearts game was exactly, obviously, conceding the goal that early and coming after that European game, as we touched on, going to Tynecastle is a cunty game, no matter which stage you're at. But to come back after, we're going to talk about it. The IZ game, I watched the first 25 minutes yet with Holt, and I don't know how he started particularly bad. And then they've scored a belting goal. It was a really good goal.
Yeah.
And the whole world's collapsed. And it was hard to watch. I didn't enjoy it, obviously. I can imagine you selling it.
No.
I just hope the boys in the stadium had a good time pre-match.
I think they did.
I've been abroad watching Celtic get humped. I mean, it's not good. It's no fun.
It's really no. You start adding it up, how much you've spent, I would imagine. Like standing here 6-9 doing things. That's like £2,000 to get here. This is shite.
Poor boys on the telly sleeping and people are waking them up.
He's famous at least.
Aye. I mean, that was a sore one for always. Like I say, Aberdeen fans seem to enjoy it. So I can only imagine. Right. So we'll come to Sunday then. Now, what would you do, but what would you expect Jack Ross to be doing in terms of formation and setting up and who's playing where?
What would I do? I would put the Australian boy back in the goal. Right. I would put Berigetti in the goal. I would put Liam Smith on the bench. I would go a back three, centre halves, but really it's a back five. And I would bring in Scott McMahon for the left. And I would bring in Kieran Freeman, our young right wing back. He gives with loads of energy. He gives you everything, actually.
Is he a good player, is he?
I think he's a good player. You know, he's going to make mistakes, but he's a good player for us. He gives you everything. He drives the team forward. He's one of these guys, you think he's like a Duracell bunny. He just, when he gets to the end of the game, he's still running. You're like, this boy never tires. And in the middle of the defence, I would hear Ross Graham, Charlie Mulgrew, if he wants to play, because there was a few games last season he missed against you boys. What's that about?
That's right.
What's that about, Scott?
He seemed to get sore leg every time.
Sore leg and a ticket for the away, and that's what he's got. So I would say Big Ross Graham, Charlie Mulgrew and Ryan Edwards. So that's my flat back five. In midfield, I'm going Levitt, Jamie McGrath, Middleton, and probably Harkes because he gives well legs, and Fletcher up front. So I'd probably keep Tony Watt on the bench as well because he's just no been in form. Now that formation, no doubt, it's going to leave gaps because it's a fairly attacking midfield. Mm-hmm, but as I've said to you about 5 minutes ago, we didn't have that guy that can just sit. We didn't have, even if you go into like the academy team and whatever at Tannadice, there's just no really anybody that plays that position for us. So it's going to be a struggle on Sunday for United. There's no doubt about that. Like it fills you with fear when you watch some of the Celtic highlights and you see how quick you guys move the ball, even the movement of your players, Jota, Kyogo. It's hard to sit here and think how we're going to get anything out of the game. Obviously, I hope I'm way wrong. You'll be hoping I'm spot on. Mm-hmm. But it's a really big task on Sunday, given what we just saw the last couple of games for United to get anything out of this. I mean, it would be bigger than last season when we beat Rangers 1-0.
I was going to say that. I mean, that one would offer hope, but I think you're right what you're saying. From you telling me that midfield, I would, Harkes aside, but Harkes hasn't proved himself to be a tough guy or something. He's kind of clumsy, and he's, I mean that in terms of trying to be the hard guy in there, because you had guys like, remember Butcher last year with that fucking terrible challenge on Tumbo and stuff. But you need to, looking at our midfield, I think our midfield will enjoy that game. It might actually be a decent game of football, but
I don't think it'll be a decent game of football. So, nah. I'm going to watch it like this. That'll be brilliant.
I'll be there as well, mate. I'll probably be watching that fucking soon. Okay. So I'm not even going to ask you for a prediction there, right? My fear is I've heard this sort of stuff before, and you've been bitten the arse. You know? I mean, it's just one of these things happen. So, I generally resort to pessimism as a protection, as my wee blanket. You know? I mean, oh, you never know. But so tell me though, in general, what is your hope for this season? I mean, I would presume what's happened so far would sway your thinking. But is it a case of consolidation again? Because you touched on, you think you've strengthened the squad. And I mean, that's what teams of Dundee United, Aberdeen, Hearts should be doing, shouldn't they? You should be getting that solid and then every year building on it, try to find somebody like a Levitt, get him to excel, make a good bit of money on him. No, just a couple of £100,000, a good fucking lad. And then you kick on for there. But
the expectations this year, as they should always be at Tannadice, in my opinion, are top six. Mm-hmm. Now, you're not a fan of the split, but the thing is, the split's there. Like, we hate to live with it, and the top six for a team like United, it does seem to be a target, because we're never going to win the league. And even getting second places, it's the stuff of dreams, really, to finish in the top two. So top six, you've got to go for that. And I base that on the fact that United are probably the sixth biggest team in the country. So top six is what we should be aiming for. Mm-hmm. And hopefully, you always aim for this, but you never expect it. You want to have a chance or a cup.
Yes.
I mean, the cup, see, it annoyed me a couple of years ago when we'd had Shabba Laszlo and whatever, and these guys in the League Cup group stages that you boys are never in, they would rest players and they wouldn't really take it serious. And as a fan, you're like, we're never winning the league here. We've got two possibilities. So if the sun shines on with a Hale Cup run, we might get to a final and might win a cup. Then I'd be resting players in the cup, you know, take these cups seriously. I don't care if it's only the League Cup. If United win the League Cup, you'll not see me for a week. I'm on it. I'm drinking in every boozer in Dundee.
Yeah.
But they pussed about with it, and for ages, our record in the League Cup group stage was honking. I mean, we struggled to get out of the bloody group stages. So I'm looking at top six, hopefully, and a very good cup run. Now, I've said that before on my own podcast. The cup run, like, it's just because you've not had a good cup run, I don't think you can automatically say, "Ah, well, it's been a poor season." Because in the fourth round, you might get Celtic away. So that's just the luck of the draw, you know. Mm-hmm. You could also get straight to the final without playing a team in the top league. It's mm-hmm. just your luck. It's just your luck. So the dream is a cup. Top six is what we've got to be aiming for. And I dare say the chairman's looking for top six as well to get some return on his investment. Because he's backed the club. He's backed mm-hmm. the recruitment team, the manager. He can't do much more other than empty his wallet completely. You know, he is putting his money where his mouth is. So he's definitely speculating to accumulate. And I think what you said about Levitt, you want to be bringing these boys in and then hopefully they have a great season and then you could sell them on for, I dare say, millions. He'd be looking for a couple of million, maybe 3 million tops or whatever. That'll be his plan. Like, as a fan, you just want Levitt to stay there as long as he wants. But that's not the way football works at this level.
Exactly.
Even you guys will bring in players and they want to go down to England because they get paid ridiculous dosh.
Exactly. I always say it, though, man. Like, people are going, "Oh, we could get 15, we could get 20 million for him." And I'm going, "Are you all getting a fucking dividend out the profits here?" Because I'm fucking...
Nothing.
I'd rather watch a player.
100%.
But it's interesting you talk about the League Cup there. Did you watch the All or Nothing with Arsenal?
No, I've not seen that yet. No.
They're chanting to their fans and stuff and all that. And they're all going, yeah, we'll go to get in the Champions League. We'll go to get fourth place in the Champions League. And I'm sitting going, why aren't any of these asking to win a trophy? Surely fucking win a trophy, you know what I mean?
Can't. It's better. You get your day. Yeah, it's exactly. Class winning a trophy.
You get 2 days if you win it. I mean, you get that semi-final, it gets yourself, and then you've got the final. So
it's very true, yeah. Yeah.
Right, mate. Paul, thank you very, very much again. Really, really good. I hope I've not came across like I'm labouring in your misery or something like that. But you've made me laugh a good few times tonight. So thank you very much for helping me out as per. Just before you go, on social media, if anybody wants to follow you, as I said, I think you're a good follow. I would recommend follow you, but it's very, very Dundee United centric.
It is, yeah. And it's unapologetically about Dundee United. I'm on Twitter as at the boy McNicholl. That's McNicoll. And I think I'm on Instagram as that as well. So if you're struggling to get to sleep at nights, feel free to log into that account, read a couple of my tweets. Out like a light, no bother.
Amazing. Right, once again, mate, thank you very much. As per my closing statement every week, I hope your team goes on after Sunday.
I appreciate that.
All right, brother.
Cheers again, Scott. Thank you very much for that.